cleanse my guilt and pride. Blood of Christ the crucified, from your hands, your feet, your side, Jesus, I trust in you.
All the suffering people go through, they many times have questions about why? Since God says this, why am I suffering? Or do I have anything to do with this? Or do I have any control? Or how long am I going to suffer? And is it necessary? All these questions usually come to people's minds, about suffering. One thing we know is, according to the Bible in Hebrews chapter 5, that Jesus had to go through suffering. It says, even though he was a son, verse 8, yet learned obedience by the things which he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became unto all them that obey him, the author of eternal salvation. People aren't wrong to be thinking about Jesus in this way, that he had to learn obedience, but it took suffering to get him there. It took suffering to get him to perfection, according to what the Bible says. The Bible also says that we're partakers of his suffering. If it was necessary for Jesus,
what type of suffering did he go through? The Bible isn't really clear about that, about the first 33 years.
Well, we're prone to only think about his sufferings on the cross, but of course, he suffered with people.
Well, the Bible said he grew in favor and stature with man and with God through the things that he suffered.
Well, I believe the Bible says that he was tempted in all points, just like us, without sin. But if he was tempted in all points like me, that's suffering.
Despised.
The suffering is
rejected of men.
The suffering is not giving in to any of those.
Right.
Desires those.
The Bible says in 1 Peter 4, it says, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which comes upon you to prove you, as though a strange thing happened unto you, inasmuch as you are partakers of Christ's sufferings. Rejoice that the revelation of his glory also you might rejoice with exceeding joy. So, we go through fiery trials to prove us just like Jesus did. We're partakers of his sufferings. The Apostle Paul said, I fill up on my part that which is lacking of the afflictions of Christ. Meaning, I take from that what God is saying is that we as the body of Christ are going through the same things Jesus did in his first body. And some people suffer more than others. I had a really strange vision a couple of mornings ago. I woke up very early and I saw myself in this very large room with a lot of other people. And there was a man walking around from table to table. Everybody seemed to be very quiet and subdued. And I was just kind of watching what was going on. There was a man walking around from table to table, and he was packing a syringe with him, a needle to inject people with. And I knew that this was a lethal injection. And while I was sitting there, the Lord spoke to me and said, this is murder. And I'm still thinking on what the Lord showed me. As I got up to leave the room, I told the people that the Lord spoke to me over there, and he told me that this is murder. And then I went down a hall and went into another very large room, and it was full of people too, and they were doing the same thing. I recognized one person that I knew in one of those rooms. Years ago, this man died with cancer. At least that's what I believe he died of. But I believe that doctors are putting people to sleep more and more commonly nowadays, But I think it's going to get more common from what that dream says. But God still considers it murder, People trying to get out of suffering. That was one of my thinking. I thought there were a lot of people there that for fear or for suffering, they just wanted to end it. And I suppose that the more tribulation comes, the more we're going to see this, And I'm quite convinced that our society is going to think it's totally normal. Euthanasia and other forms of putting people out of their misery. That's like jumping out of a frying pan into the fire, I was thinking about what Job said. Job, I made a note when I was reading Job one time, how that Job said, pray to God, Lord, just loose your hand and let me go. Never in his mind was the thought of suicide, but he asked God to do it. That's Job chapter 6. He says, oh, that I might have my request, and that God would grant me the thing that I long for, even that I would, that it would please God to crush me, that he would let loose his hand and cut me off. But nowhere in the book of Job do you ever see him giving thought to suicide. But what God was telling me in that little vision was that, hey, that's murder. Even if you're murdering self, that's still murder. They're wheeling babies that are born, that are unwanted, over to the side and not feeding them until they die. In some cases, I really don't disagree with what they're doing, but in cases like that, that's just murder. You know, when people, because they don't want to go through trials or tribulations, God's way, and believe in the promises of God, especially in the midst of that, they take their life. That's murder. If anybody destroys this temple, the Lord will destroy him. The Bible says, 1 Corinthians chapter 3.
I guess I'm listening to what you're saying, but I'm putting things in my mind too. Myself, my family, other Christians that come to the salon. Because most of the teachings that I think I've sat under over here was, when you're under sickness, pray and have faith that it'll be rebuked or whatever. You know. Of course, we've also talked about where if it didn't happen instantly, to endure that until the end of that trial. So you're talking about enduring the suffering of that affliction until the manifestation of your prayer is. Is that what you're talking about? Am I understanding this correctly?
Many are the
suffering and the affliction.
Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth him out of them all. A lot of people think there's something righteous about enduring affliction without believing God to manifest the sacrifice. We have a good example across Apostle Paul. You know, the Bible says that lest he be exalted overmuch, there was giving him an angel of Satan to buffet him. And a lot of people pervert that into meaning that he had a particular sickness that stayed with him and God said he wouldn't take it away from him. But he was given this angel of Satan so that God could deal with his pride, because he said that he wouldn't be exalted over much, so that he wouldn't be more important to people than he should be, I guess.
Or what Job was dealing with.
Yeah. It buffeted him, too. I mean, here's something you got to think about when, you know, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, he called it a buffeting. And I looked that up one time, and I discovered that it's not one thing of whatever you might think it is. It's many blows, many, many blows. And he describes, of course, in chapter 11, what these blows were, these weaknesses were, and it was afflictions from his countrymen, and in the depths of the ocean, and in the torments from the Gentiles, and just one thing after another. He went through all these things. And like he said, out of them all, the Lord delivered me. And he said he will deliver me from every evil work. So the Apostle Paul didn't have the thinking that a lot of people have nowadays, that there's something righteous in just suffering. I believe suffering happens in order to motivate us to repent and to do what God has called us to do in the Scriptures. It just seems, I mean, the Lord Jesus had to suffer to come to perfection. It just seems because of our flesh that he chastens every son he receives, the Bible says. And chastening, I mean, if you look up the word chastening, it's basically the same thing, you know, that I looked it up one time, I think Vines said it was to suffer the affliction of evils or calamities, is what he said, to suffer the affliction of evils or calamities. Well, he says he does this to every son that he receives. You'd think, well, couldn't we be spiritual enough that we wouldn't need chastening? I think that some people need less chastening than others, but that everybody needs chastening because he said so. If the Lord Jesus had to go through suffering to crucify his flesh, than we do. And he said, verse 5, Hebrews 12 and 5, he says, have you forgotten the exhortation which reasoneth with you as with sons? My son, regard not lightly the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art reproved of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and he scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. He scourges every son whom he receives.
David, can I ask one? I mean, it's in line with what you're talking about. I think I asked this once before. because I was under the impression sometimes that a chastening, a trial, something to do with a sickness or whatever, or, you know, where we would rebuke the devil, or we would direct our attention toward the devil having plundering us in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm thinking this way, going back to Proverbs, where it says, the curse allotteth not without a cause. In Job's case, it was, you know, a lot of people use the argument, well, you know, the devil approached the Lord, and so the Lord was going to use Job as an example of a servant who would stay true no matter what the devil did.
Mm-hmm.
But underneath the whole scenario, the very foundation of what God was doing was trying to get something out of Job that he wasn't pleased with. It was in his heart. It was hidden. Didn't know about.
So self-righteous.
Yeah, my question is that these things that Paul was going through, and he was asking God to remove that thorn, they were things that were being buffeting, and he was being delivered from those. And even Job, when he says that, I know the Lord is doing this to me, but well, he would just really, and even he was asking God to, you know, uncle, mm-hmm. you know, type thing.
Yeah,
I'm not totally sure the question I'm trying to ask, other than the fact that, because I used to think sometimes, maybe it wasn't so much that I was being bad, or that there was something in me that was bad, or whatever, that I was going through what I was going through, but maybe it was just a situation of that I was being tried,
mm-hmm.
you know. So I used to get the trial confused with chastisement, or the chastisement confused with...
Well, can't God be doing both at the same time? I think in almost every instance he is doing both at the same time, because he's a great coordinator. You know, when we get delivered over to chastening, which we can see from the scriptures, God does that, like in 1 Corinthians 5 and verse 5, he does it in 1 Timothy also. When we get delivered over to the devil for chastening, you know, Abraham was accounted righteous because he believed God. He was in the midst of a trial. I mean, to them, to be barren was a big problem, you know. He believed God. God justified him. And he was given access to grace, according to Romans chapter 5, verse 1 and 2, because God justified him. What about the people that go all their lives through the same torment or trial because they don't believe God? There seems to be no end to their trouble. It's because they don't believe God. Doesn't that chastening then become chastening upon people's unbelief? Yeah. I think while you're going through the midst of the trial, you're supposed to believe God. See, Abraham was in that trial for 40 years, believing God. And that's what he's supposed to be doing. That's the thing, reason that God justified him, is because that's what he was doing. But we see a lot of people around us that they never come out of the trial. Sometimes even dying, because, you know, my people are destroyed for lack of understanding. So, to me, it's not an either or. If you're going through a trial, it can be a chastening, it can be a trial. And at the same time, you're supposed to be believing God, believing God's word, so that God can justify you and account you as righteous, in other words, you know. Even while the Apostle Paul was going through one thing after another, because he was preaching the gospel to these wicked people,
well, you were
he was believing that God was delivering from every evil work.
Yeah. Quote. I guess I thought maybe you were getting some of this from, like, you know, the Church of the Presbyterians, where you speak sometimes, and some of the other Bible studies that you go to, that you speak to some of the people that haven't had the faith teaching that, you know, maybe we've had over here from whatever. And so I guess I guess you was getting that picture of the suffering, that we're not willing to suffer until the trials come to the end, that we either run to the world or just give up and accept the condemnation or accept the trial. Is, you know, is that what you're saying?
Well, we should endure the trial of our chastening. We shouldn't run from it. And see, it says right here in verse 7 where we left off in Hebrews 12, it says, it's for chastening that you endure. God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is there whom his father chasteneth not? But if you're without chastening, whereof you've all been made partakers, then are you bastards and not sons. Furthermore, we had our fathers, the fathers of our flesh, to chasten us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? They indeed, for a few days, chastened us as it seemed good to them. But he for our profit, that we may be partakers of his holiness. All chastening seems, for the present, to be not joyous but grievous, yet afterwards it yields peaceable fruit unto them that have been exercised thereby, even the fruit of righteousness. So God saying chastening brings forth holiness and righteousness, and that we should endure it patiently, understanding that God's doing it for our good.
Can you repent in your mind and unknowingly not do it in your heart and thinking that then at that point you're justified, or having a false feeling of release or freedom? Because I remember going to the Assembly of God church that I attended for so many years, and especially after I came back as a Christian. I would fall into things and go to the altar, and I would really feel relieved. I mean, I would feel, in my mind anyway, I'm looking back now and seeing that there was some, the devil met me down there and gave me a false sense of repentance. And in my mind, I really thought I had. And I'm seeing this also with a lot of the Christians that come into the shop. They've said they've repented. You know, they've confessed their repentance. Mm-hmm. But is the church under the situation of a false repentance and a false feeling of having, you know, because there is a release or a good feeling, I'll say it that way, an emotional, you know, a fleshly emotion.
The sorrow of the world, Paul called.
Yeah.
He said the sorrow of the world works in regret, but godly sorrow works in repentance. So there are people that, I mean, yeah, they've got worldly sorrow, but they go down there and they cry out to the Lord and they go back and they never change their mind. The Bible says, because godly sorrow works repentance, which means a change of mind
when you're confronted with that same situation again.
See, yeah, some people, I mean, we have to be motivated to change our mind. I mean, Job, the experience he went through, first of all, it was like you were saying a minute ago, he didn't recognize the self-righteousness of it. It was through this thing that he was made willing to face this situation, and through what God said to him when he cried out to God in prayer. When he cried out to God in prayer, and the Lord answered him, showed him his self-righteousness, sent him Elihu to speak to him words of truth that showed him his self-righteousness. Well, the people are particularly willing to listen when they're suffering.
You know, I don't mean to be taking up the whole, you know, a lot of questions, but things just kept coming to my mind, like my daughter at the time that she was in prison, gosh, the letters that she would write me at the time that she has, you know, I call it jailhouse religion now, but at the time I really thought she had something, and so easily lost it after she got out. And Benjamin, in the letters that he's written me over this last 4 or 5 months or 6 months or whatever, every one of them, up into this last one on their situation that caught him off guard, he totally lost it. The whole letter was so condemning and so judgmental and so bitterness, you know, you could feel it, you know. And in my own self, too, in situations I look back over, I can see where in the trial, or especially if I failed it, you know, I understood that the repentance was at the time when you admitted and confess. But I'm seeing now that a lot of times when I thought I had confessed and when I thought I had repented or when I thought I had, you know, made that commitment, and in other people's lives that I've been talking to here in the last few weeks, maybe even in my mom's at times when she says I believe or when she says I agree, or in other people I've prayed for and then I didn't see that prayer answered. But at the time that we agreed, you know, it's just that I'm seeing in my life and other people's lives I'm talking to a false sense of repentance, or maybe a lack of understanding of what repentance is.
The Bible says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 4, it says, so that we ourselves glory in you in the churches of God for your patience and faith in all your persecutions and in the afflictions that you endure. In your patience and faith in all your persecutions and in the afflictions that you endure, which is a manifest token of the righteous judgment of God, to the end that you may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God. So it's only a token of what we could receive, honestly, but a token of the righteous judgment of God. On what? On our old fleshly thinking and fleshly ways. And the reason, of course, is so that we may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God, for which we also suffer. That's verse 5, 2 Thessalonians 1, 5. Well, I remembered, when I was thinking on this today a little bit, I remembered this story that was given. Well, it's not a story, it's an angel of the Lord came to Dimitri Dudeman, shared with him about what was going to happen between here and the destruction of America, what God was going to do to get people ready to meet the Lord at that time. And two angels came to him and spoke to him and revealed some things to him. Let me read just a little bit of it to you. It says, "And one of them said to me, 'I came to talk with you. I will send great plagues over America, and I want you to be aware. I'm the one who talked with you in the past, and I'm talking with you now. And I told you that what will happen in this place. Be cautious, for the time is drawing near.' After saying these words, he took out a scroll, which began to unroll very quickly. It was so long that I could not see its end. On this first scroll of paper were written all kinds of names. Beside each name was listed their punishment, a type of a disease, and all kinds were listed. A trial or a torment. Those named will have to go through what is listed by their name in order to be cleansed and be able to stand." This is what the angel told him. That scroll was then rolled up and sealed, and a second one was brought out, and on it was written peace and joy in the Holy Spirit, salvation or victory for those that loved me and worked for me and kept their lives clean, not for the hypocrites, the proud, the boastful, the hateful, nor others which I cannot recall. The scroll continued to pass by slowly before my eyes until it had finished passing. Then the third scroll opened up, and this had names written on it. Yet there was something written only beside the names on the top half. From halfway marked down by each name, there were flashing stars. And I asked what this meant. And one of the angels said to me, "These are those with whom the number will be completed. The seed of God has reached their hearts and is even now working towards repentance. When the total number will be complete, all of the devastation will begin. Until then, I will send great plagues over America that they may wake up from their sleep with which they are sleeping and from their self-reliance, that they may see their pride and boastfulness. It then began to rain with ice and hail, and the people were scattering all over, not knowing which way to go. From the terror of the screams, I woke up. This dream was so real to me that I went immediately outside to see if it was happening at that moment." So he was saying, look, we all these different sicknesses and trials and torments were going to come upon people to cleanse them and to make them to be able to stand and to cause them to repent and to get them prepared for this judgment on America. It sounded like there were a lot of lesser judgments leading up to the big judgment, but the lesser judgments were going to get God's people ready, you know. Here's a little revelation that I really enjoyed, and I learned something from, and I thought it was a blessing. It also is an angel appearing to Hermas, who was a first century prophet, and really blessed with some wonderful revelations. But this angel gave a lot of understanding about suffering, why Christians suffer, how long must they suffer. There's some really interesting things in there. Let me read a little bit of it.
One of the things I was thinking of as we're talking about this particular subject is that, you know, it's written in Scripture about the chastening and saying that the Father chastens the Son. The problem that we see with the churches today is that this doctrine that it's, you know, that when somebody's sick, it's Satan that's bringing the sickness on them. And so it's really hard when you're dealing with somebody to even speak chastening to them, because chastening involves being, you know, that there's something that's happening to you because of something that you did.
Right.
Okay, or because of where you are with your walk with the Lord and that you're not being obedient.
Yeah.
And they get real defensive.
And so they get very defensive, so it's hard to speak that. And the reason it's hard to speak that is because the church doesn't teach the Bible.
Yes.
What they teach is, you know, is that, you know, there's this this devil out there with a pitchfork and he's coming against you, and so, you know, it's always the devil is doing this, and there's no sovereignty of God above all that.
Right.
But a good example is if we could understand it properly, then we could see God's love behind all this. Because take, for example, my next door neighbor that they just came and got and hauled him off to the hospital. And in all the years that I've known him, I've never had a single conversation with the man about the Lord, because there's never been anything there. Other than, you know, it's like, you know, you say something about the Lord and it's just, you know, for he and his wife. And yet, if the church was teaching things properly, there could be an understanding of the love of the Lord that before this judgment comes on America, and he's going to do things to those that he's going to draw, give them opportunities to repent, give them opportunities to put their attention to him.
Yeah.
And that's where everywhere you look right now, it doesn't matter if it's a man counting disease or AIDS or, you know, what the problems that are here in America and the fact that the economy could collapse. And of course, when the economy
collapses, the flood, everything. You know?
Yeah, when the economy goes, it's going to be stepped up a notch to where everybody's going to be in that boat, Derek. All of a sudden, some people will look up and some other people will try to scurry about to try to save themselves, but other people will look up.
Yeah.
And I just am aware that as we're talking about this suffering, that it is a problem that is there from the doctrine of what comes out of these apostate religions that keeps people from being able to receive the blessings of understanding the sovereignty of God.
Chastening is to bring us to maturity and perfection, and the quicker we get there, the quicker we'll get out of it. But this angel did tell him one thing. He told Hermas one thing. He said, keep these things. He was talking about these commandments, and all trouble will leave you. And trouble will leave all, he said, who walk in these my commandments. So there should be an end of this, you know, of the troubles that we're going through, of the buffetings of Satan that God permits, sends upon us. Let me read some of this to you. Some of it's really good. It said, while I was sitting in my house and glorifying the Lord for all that I had seen and reflecting on the commandments because they were fine and powerful and joyous and glorious, and able to save the souls of men, I said to myself, I will be blessed if I walk in these commandments, and whoever walks in them will be blessed. While I was saying this to myself, I unexpectedly saw him sitting beside me, saying these things. This was the shepherd who came to give Hermas these revelations. Why are you double-minded about the commandments which I have commanded you? They are fine. Be not double-minded at all, but put on the faith of the Lord and walk in them, for I will strengthen you in them. These commandments are beneficial for those who are going to repent, for if they do not walk in them, their repentance is in vain. Same thing you were saying, Kurt. So you who repent must put aside the evils of this world which destroy you, and by putting on every virtue of righteousness, you will be able to keep these commandments and act no longer to your sins. So by adding nothing, you will cut off much of your former sins. So walk in my commandments, and you will live to God. All these things have been spoken to you by men. After he had spoken these things with me, he said to me, let us go into the country, and I will show you the shepherds of the sheep. Let us go, sir, I said. He came to some plain, and he showed me a young shepherd wearing a suit of clothes, yellow in color. He was tending very many sheep, and these sheep seemed as if they were living luxuriously and indulgently. He describes luxuriously later as Everything, he said, which a man likes to do is a luxury for him. For even the man who is ill-tempered lives in luxury when he satisfies his passions. So what he's calling luxury is something that you really can't afford to do, you know, something that's too costly for you to do it, like give in to your lust or your passions or whatever. So this shepherd in yellow was the shepherd over the sheep who were living in luxury and indulgent. In other words, getting into their flesh, right? And were joyous as they skipped here and there. And the shepherd himself was most joyous over his flock. Even the appearance of the shepherd was very joyful. He ran about among the sheep, and I saw in one place other sheep living indulgently and luxuriously, but they were not skipping about. You know, it lets you know that there are people out there that are quite happy living indulgently and luxuriously. In other words, totally carefree, totally giving into their flesh, but they're quite happy. Apparently, happy in the Lord, but mostly just happy in the flesh. Because there's no restraint. You know, they're just happy. He said to me, "Do you see this shepherd?" He said, "Yes, I see him, sir. This, sir, he is the angel of luxury and deception. He destroys the souls of the servants of God who are empty and turns them away from the truth by deceiving them with evil desires in which they are destroyed. For they forgot the commandments of the living God and walk in deception and vain luxury and are destroyed by this angel, some to death and some to corruption." I said to him, "Sir, I do not know what to death and to corruption mean." "Listen," he said, "the sheep which you see that are very joyful and are skipping about are the ones who have completely withdrawn from God and have given themselves over to the desires of this world. For these, then, there is no repentance unto life, for in addition they have blasphemed against the name of the Lord. For such, then, there is death. But the ones you saw not skipping about, but feeding in one place, are those who have given themselves over to luxury and deceit, but have not blasphemed against the Lord. So these are corrupted from the truth. For them, then there is hope of repentance, by which they are able to live. So corruption has some hope of renewal, but death has eternal destruction." Again, we went on a little further, and he showed me a large shepherd who seemed wild in appearance, wearing a white goatskin. And he had a bag on his shoulder and a very hard and knotted staff in his hand with a great whip. And he had a very bitter lip, so that I was afraid of him and such a lip that he had. This shepherd, then, was receiving from the young shepherd the sheep, those that were living indulgently and luxuriously but not skipping about. And he set them in a certain precipitous place full of thorns and thistles so that the sheep were unable to disentangle themselves from the thorns and the thistles, but were caught in the thorns and thistles. So they were feeding while entangled in the thorns and the thistles and being beaten by him. They were very miserable. He was driving them about here and there, and he gave them no rest at all. Those sheep had no place at all. So when I saw them so flogged and so miserable, I was distressed on their account because they were so tormented and had no relief at all. And I said to the shepherd who was speaking with me, "Sir, who is this shepherd who is so merciless and bitter and has no compassion at all for these sheep?" "This," said he, "is the angel of punishment. He belongs to the righteous angels, but he is in charge of punishment. He receives them, those who have strayed from God and walked in desires and deceptions of this world, and he punishes them, as is fitting, with various terrible punishments." "I would like to know, sir," I said, "what these various punishments are like." "Listen," said he, "to the various torments and punishments. The torments befall one during his earthly life. For some are punished with losses, some with deprivations, and some with various illnesses, some with total disservice, and some are abused by unworthy persons and suffer many other things. For since many are unsettled in their decisions," I guess he's talking about unsteadfast people, "they try many things, and nothing at all succeeds for them. And they say that they do not prosper in their affairs. and it does not enter their hearts that they have done evil deeds, but they blame the Lord. Many people blame the Lord. Many people blame the Lord in the midst of their trials and troubles and tribulations. They don't believe they're worthy of them, and they blame the Lord. So whenever they suffer every kind of affliction, they are turned over to me for good instruction and are strengthened in the faith of the Lord and serve the Lord with pure hearts the rest of the days of their lives. By the way, that's a verse that sounds very similar to that in 1 Peter 4, 1 and 2. I'll read that to you. He says, "For as much then as Christ suffered in the flesh, arm ye yourselves also with the same mind, for he that has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so that you no longer should live the rest of your time in the flesh to the lusts of men, but to the will of God." So this suffering is to cause people to cease from sin so that they could live the rest of their time useful to the Lord and useful to his kingdom and useful to themselves, I guess. "Then whenever they repent, the evil deeds which they did come to their hearts. And then they glorify God because he is a righteous judge. And because each one," if you remember, that was true of Job. Job started out blaming the Lord, and the further he got into it, the more revelation he got, the more he realized that he deserved what God had given him, and he glorified God. The Lord educated him through the midst of his trouble and his tribulation. "And because each one rightly suffered everything for what he had done." In other words, the Lord says he's going to render to every man according to his works. There's no accidents in chastening. I mean, you know, you don't get an accidental chastening. The devil just happened to jump out from behind a bush and give you something you didn't deserve. What God is saying is he's got control over this.
These are all things that the Lord does not take the penalty for under the curse that we're speaking of here.
Things he's chastening his children to give them a reason to repent.
Right. Because the Lord is not taking the penalty for these things.
Right. "From then on, they will serve the Lord with their hearts pure and prosper in all that they do, receiving from the Lord all that they ask. And then they glorify the Lord because they are turned over to me and no longer suffer any evil." For me, huh? So that obviously the Lord plans for us to come to the place where we don't suffer any evil. Learn through the evil that we go through, and we come to a place and we don't suffer any evil. I said to him, "Sir," this is really interesting, listen to this. I said to him, "Sir, explain something else to me." "What do you want to know?" he said. "What is, sir," said I, "those who live luxuriously and in self-deception are tormented for the same time as they lived in luxury and self-deception?" He said to me, "They are tormented for the same time." I'm reminded of Revelation chapter 18, and verse 7 it says, "How much soever she glorified herself and waxed wanton or luxurious," actually my footnote says luxurious, "so much give her of torment and mourning." In other words, however much she glorified herself, however much she lived in luxury, just that much give her torment and mourning, he says. So I think there's a little biblical foundation for believing this. He said they're tormented for the same time, sir. "They are tormented too little for those," he says, "they are tormented too little for those who live in luxury and forget God ought to be tormented sevenfold." This is what Herman said. He said to me, "You're foolish, and you do not understand the power of torment." "Well, sir," I said, "if I had understood, I would not have asked you to explain it to me." "Listen," said he, "to the power of both. The time of luxury and deception is 1 hour, but an hour of torment has the power of 30 days. So if anyone lives in luxury and self-deception for 1 day and is tormented for 1 day, the day of torment has the impact of a whole year." He's going to explain this. "So a man is tormented for as many years as days he lives in luxury. You see then," he said, "that the time of luxury and deception is very short, while the punishment and the torment is great." Meaning it might be the same amount of time, but it has the power of much more. "Sir," I said, "since I do not understand at all about the times of deception and luxury and of torment, explain it more clearly to me." He answered and said, "Your foolishness is persistent, and you do not wish to purify your heart and serve God. Be careful. He said, let the time be fulfilled and you still be found foolish. Listen then, he said, so that you understand these things just as you wish. The one who lives in luxury and self-deception for one day and does as he pleases has put on considerable foolishness and does not know what he is doing. For on the next day he forgets what he has done the day before. For luxury and deception have no memory because of the foolishness in which they are clothed. But when punishment and torment cling to a man for one day, he is punished and tormented for a year. For punishment and torment have long memories. So when a man is tormented and punished for a whole year, then he remembers the luxury and deception, and he knows that he suffers evil because of them. So every man who lives in luxury and self-deception is tormented in this way. For even though they have life, they have given themselves over to death. Sir, said I, what sort of luxury are harmful? Everything, he said, which a man likes to do, is a luxury for him. For even the man who is ill-tempered lives in luxury when he satisfies his passion. And the adulterer, and the drunkard, and the slanderer, and the liar, and the one who covets, and the robber, and the one who does such things as these, satisfies his own sickness. So he lives in luxury by his own action. All these luxuries are harmful to the servant of God. So because of these deceptions, those who are punished and tormented are suffering. But there are also luxuries which save men. For many live in luxury because they are moved to do good by their own pleasure. So this luxury is advantageous for the servants of God and brings life to such a man. But the harmful luxuries mentioned before bring torments and punishments. And if they persist and do not repent, they bring death on themselves. A few days later, I saw him in the same plain where I'd also seen the shepherds, and he said to me, what do you want to know? I'm here to ask you, sir, said I, to command the punishing shepherd to leave my house. For he troubles me very much. It's necessary for you to be troubled, he said. For so has the glorious angel given orders concerning you. For he wants you to be tested. Why, what have I done so evil, sir, said I, that I should be given over to this angel? Listen, he said, your sins are many, but not such that you ought to be given over to this angel. But your house has done great sins and iniquities, and the glorious angel has become embittered by their deeds. And for this reason he ordered you to be troubled for a while so that they might repent and cleanse themselves of all the desires of this world. For whenever they repent and are cleansed, then the angel of punishment will leave you. I said to him, sir, even if they have done such things that the glorious angel has become embittered, what have I done? There's no other way that they can be troubled, he said. We talked about this before here. And if you, the head of the house, be troubled. But when you're troubled, they of necessity will also be troubled. But while you prosper, they can have no trouble. But look, sir, I said, they have repented with all their hearts. I also know, he said, that they have repented with all their hearts. Do you think, he said, that the sins of those who repent are immediately forgiven? By no means. But the one who repents must torment his own soul and be extremely humble in everything that he does and be troubled different kinds of tribulations. And if he endures the tribulations that come to him, surely the one who created and enabled all things will have compassion and give him healing. In other words, sometimes you may suffer for the same amount of period that you're in your foolishness, but the suffering don't necessarily start the same day your foolishness does. God's merciful, and sometimes he doesn't chasten us until we've been into this thing for a while, and he sends chastening.
But I have a question. Punishment and the torment, a year for the day that you lived in luxury.
Well, you're saying a day for a day, but that day,
the day has the effects.
Effects.
And I guess my question is, after repentance, where does all, now you just read something about after repentance. Now, assuming someone has done this and they have repented,
mm-hmm.
the lingering effects that make it feel like a year for that day. Is that what you're saying? Is that what he's saying in there?
Yeah, what he's saying is just because you repent don't mean it's going to stop immediately. I mean, how many times do you repent and go for prayer and you pray for a healing? But
so that's pretty much the same, the analogy that if you've planted a bad crop, you now begin to reap that. And pretty much if you plant a bad crop, now you're going to eat of that bad crop for a season of time.
Well, isn't it like this? Your child comes to you, they've done something willfully wrong, and you say, I'm going to spank you. And they say, but I didn't have. And you say, well, yeah, but you did it with your will, so I'm going to spank you. And when the spanking's over, it's over, because you did repent, I'm not going to keep spanking you. I'm going to stop. You know? Isn't that the way with us? I mean, if all they had to do was say the magic words, I repent, and they never paid any penalty for what they did, then why would they not do it again the next time?
Because also very similar, just like with David with Bathsheba.
Yeah,
he repented. But the Lord still chasing David all the rest of his days through no peace in his family.
Yeah, that's
but that was his,
yeah. That in was, every case, the Lord.
And the reason that that was studied before was, of course, that was not a sin that was taken at the cross. What I mean is, David did that sin with willful disobedience.
Yeah,
he was aware and was knowledgeable and was held accountable before God. Yeah. And I think we're dealing with Christians here. What we're talking about is Christians with willful disobedience. And again, this kind of holds true to the fact, just like it was in the scriptures, that the Lord just don't wave a wand and just say, go on, you know.
Yeah.
You have, like you said, you've sown that crop and you will reap that crop.
You know, in Job's case, he wasn't willfully disobeying. He was ignorant. But it took the suffering to bring out what he was doing that was wrong before God, and the thing that God didn't like in his life, you know, he didn't obviously see it right away. The suffering is what brought it out. The prayer and the grief towards God and the things that God said to him, both through Elihu and personally to him, you know, brought all this out. But I don't necessarily think we're talking about just willful disobedience here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we many times get chastened and we ask, Lord, what was that for?
Mm-hmm.
And as we examine our conscience or think about it, the Lord tells us what it was for. And it's not that we have in our consciousness this sin that we're just waiting on God to beat us for because we know we've done wrong, you know. In some cases, it's not even that way.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I believe that we think that chastening only comes upon things that we do wrong instead of on the old man. You know, I mean, what was Job doing wrong? None of those guys could convict him of sin. Everything they said about him was a lie. It wasn't what he had done. It was what he was that God was chastening him. There was self-righteousness down in him that God wanted to get out of him. And
there was one thing that was said that sort of confused me, because he said that your sin isn't forgiven right away, even with repentance.
What he means here by forgiveness is he's not taking the penalty away right away. You know, he's not forgetting.
But when you repent,
yeah,
and ask forgiveness, it is forgiven.
Right.
But there was a question still possibly after those through some stuff, though.
Yeah. Well, is it true? How many times do we pray for one another for something, healing or whatever, and the manifestation doesn't come immediately?
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes it doesn't come immediately.
Well, I was sort of understanding that maybe the sin wasn't really forgiven until the end of the trial or the end of the chastening.
Well, I think what he's meaning by forgiveness here is not holding it against you as far as the debt either.
Yeah. Removal of the penalty.
Yeah, that's right. The removal of the
spirit man is forgiven, but the fleshly man has to suffer the consequences.
And if it's true, you know, that God starts chastening us is when we go into something that's displeasing to him, and he starts chastening us sometime after we go into it, that if he does chasten us for an equal time that we've been giving ourselves over to this foolishness, that the penalty may last a little bit longer than the time that we're in. It says, if he sees that the heart of the one who repented is clean of every evil deed, but it is beneficial for you and your house to be troubled at this time. But why do I tell you so many things? You must be troubled just as the angel of the Lord who gave you over to me has ordered. And give thanks to the Lord for this, that he considered you worthy to show you the tribulation beforehand, so that knowing of it in advance, you may bear it bravely. And I said unto him, Sir, you stay with me, and I will be able to endure every tribulation. I will be with you, he said, and I will ask the punishing angel to trouble you more lightly. But you will be troubled for a little while, and you will be restored again to your place. Only continue to be humble-minded, and serve the Lord with a pure heart, both your children and your household, and walk in my commandments which I give you, and your repentance shall be strong and pure. And if you and your family keep these things, all trouble will leave you, and trouble will leave all, he said, who walk in these my commandments. Well, to most of the church, they don't think they can ever walk in his commandments, in obedience to his commandments. They don't have faith to believe that. And so they never would come to the place where God had delivered them from chastening. But obviously that's God's plan. He said that after you have suffered a little while, himself will perfect, establish, and strengthen you. What is that? 1 Peter chapter 5, right? And 10. And the God of all grace, who called you unto his eternal glory in Christ, after that you have suffered a little while, shall himself perfect, establish, and strengthen you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. So what is that? I mean, why is it, in this particular text, he said, after you've suffered a little while, he shall perfect you. So obviously, suffering is to perfect you. And it is to establish you. What is the first, what is, somebody else got something besides establish? In 1 Peter 4, 5 and 10? Just so we can get a clearer understanding of that.
Make you perfect, establish, strengthen.
Establish and strengthen. So, suffering is to strengthen you, make you strong in the Lord, and it is to establish you. What comes to mind when somebody's not established? They're not steadfast, they're not
double-minded.
Yeah, double-minded.
They're not on solid ground.
Not on solid ground, yeah. So he promised that you would suffer a little while, and then he would do these things. Well, there's an awful lot of suffering going on. I'm amazed at the number of people who have called me just because they enjoyed the program that they heard. And while in our speech, they're telling me what they're going through, you know, and asking for prayer. You know, there's a lot of Christians suffering right now. I was just amazed, you know.
Well, if Job was, you know, most of the church looks at Job as a very righteous man because of his power and his wealth and, you know, how God had blessed him.
But well, I think he is or was a very righteous man, you know.
Yeah.
And the Lord said of Job that these guys weren't right, what they said to Job. And the Lord said of Job, a perfect and an upright man. He called him a perfect and an upright man. And so he was a righteous man. But God was interested in not just what he did. God was interested in what was down in his heart. And God was interested in perfecting him. And so he brought him through that trial.
Whenever we talk about suffering, I always go through this thing in my mind as far as vessels of honor, vessels of dishonor, and how God tends to work and chasten them and deal with these two different types of vessels. And he deals with them quite differently. One is that as a vessel of dishonor, I see out in the world that it may be the vessel of dishonor for that person as a vessel of dishonor for that particular time in their life and in their walk. But there could be somebody that could be with intercessory prayer, that could be petitioning the Lord to act upon this person, and that person could be chastened severely.
Mm-hmm.
And so just as sons of God are chastened, even vessels of dishonor, as they appear right then, are chastened also. And then I see other vessels of dishonor, and I say vessels of dishonor in that they have no light, they have no, their living's put in hell wide open, they're, you know, down the street, and they're watching the stock market, and they have no yeah. price in them.
Okay? Yeah.
There's no proof. And I look at them, and they just go along their happy way, and a lot of times, the money's there, the help's there, because, you know, they're just vessels of dishonor. Lord, you know, the Lord is just leaving them.
Let them go.
Leaving them to themselves. He's not chastening them. He's not drawing them. until somebody with intercessory prayer. So it's funny or amazing how we can pray for God to intercede, and all of a sudden that person's world's turned upside down.
Mm-hmm.
But we can, when we read scripture, and we come to a little bit of a better understanding of the sovereignty of God and how He works through His people, we can understand how a person's world could be turned upside down. That is God's love.
Mm-hmm.
But we, you know, when during the period of chastening, of course, we feel differently.
Yeah.
Okay. But I think that it's a very unfortunately sad situation to hear what it is that you just said, which is something that we always see if we walk. If we were to go tonight and walk down the mall, we see all these faces that are passing us, and so much of the curse. And if you stopped and talked to 10 people, there is so much sickness, and there's so much cancer, and so much infirmity, and so much depression, that there is a curse that's everywhere. And because of the message that comes out of apostate religion, there's no understanding of what we talk about here, that the curse that is causeless availeth not. And it's true, these people are not availed to any enlightenment or any understanding as to a curse that's befallen them, because they continually look back on the fact that that curse was brought to me, Satan's coming against me. And it's amazing how the misunderstanding of the scriptures, these people actually a lot of times are suffering not at the hands of suffering for Christ. They're suffering for a penalty or for what Christ has brought. You know, the Lord has allowed suffering to come on somebody. And they're taking glory in the fact that they're accursed. They're saying that I'm suffering peaceably, and this is, you know, Christ's way is to suffer in silence. And yet, what the Lord would like them to do is to know God's word, walk in God's word, and speak God's word, and come into the promises and the blessings, and to do away with the curse.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just this massive confusion that's there in this world around us.
So the curse can only be lifted through repentance.
Well,
it's not to our benefit that it would be without repentance and faith. It's not to our benefit.
It's lifted sometimes for a short time or a long time, but, you know, for the glory of God, scriptures say, for God's glory.
Yeah. Well, I was just thinking about a couple of sisters that came through here that never really obeyed what they were hearing, and how the Lord delivered them over to the Berean fellowship, you know, and now they don't believe it. Listen, they don't believe in speaking in tongues. They don't believe in anything in the Bible from Colossians on, because it was all written to the Jews. They have totally been delivered over to this foolishness, you know.
It's just like we say, see with Brother Stare.
They believe in the rapture, all flyaway rapture. Yeah, after all that they listen to, it's like it's gone.
With God, disciples today are being made of false prophets. That's the disciples that are being made, disciples from false prophets. And they walk, they talk, and they speak, and they say the same thing of their teachers of apostate religion, you know, legalism, whatever it is. And it's because they tend to believe their teachers rather than to believe what this word.
Can quench my thirsting soul. Purest water, make me whole. Let your streams of mercy flow. Oh Jesus, I trust in you. Though the mountains fall into the sea, though the rivers rise, I still believe. For your mercy stands and your word is true. Oh Jesus, I trust in you.